Hi, this is Scott Erickson with Digital Technology Group and DTGweb.com. Welcome to our unboxing, assembly and setup video for the new Epson P9570 44-inch photo and fine art printer. Now, if you're also interested or purchased the P7570, this video will serve as a guide as well, as nearly everything is identical, just the size of the printer. So 24-inch versus 44-inch. Now, a little bit about Digital Technology Group. We are a complete solutions provider for the photo, fine art, signage, tech, digital textile industries, selling digital captures, scanners, digital cameras, printing equipment output from Epson, Canon, and HP, as well as color management gear from X-Rite and Barbieri. And finally, we offer all of the print supplies for these printers, ink, paper, canvas, vinyl, all kinds of media for these as well. So with that said, the P9570, this guy is basically the latest and greatest in terms of technology from Epson. Features dedicated black ink channels, which is a big feature for those that are used to printing with Epson printers in the past that require switching from photo to matte black. Now it's dedicated, there is no switching. Also features black enhanced overcoat for basically some of the richest, deepest blacks that you'll ever see on papers. Also features a expanded color gamut with a new violet ink, so we can hit any even more Pantone colors as well as wider color spaces for those fine art reproductions that really require a lot of color gamut. Also features a new print head, so this guy flies because it's got a really, really large print head, 2.5 times as fast as the previous generation. And finally, basically, Epson has done a lot to make this printer a lot more reliable in terms of operation. One, it's sealed everywhere. They've got all of the dust prevention on this, and the gaskets and things like that are really, really well engineered, as well as the ability to actually physically maintain the printer. So they now give us access to the capping station to where we can go in there, wipe around those caps and keep those clean. Also wipe around the print head area, keep that clean. What that translates to, fewer nozzle clogs, as well as a much longer print duration life of the printer. So with that said, obviously you can see the printer and the box that it comes in is very big. You know, the 7570 is gonna end about here, but it does come on a pallet, all right? So when you're ordering your printer from DTGweb.com or your sales rep, make sure that you specify whether you need a lift gate on that truck. Or if you have a dock, or you can ready to receive that coming right off the freight truck, because it does come via freight. This thing is big and it's heavy, and you will need help setting it up. So with that said, we'll go ahead and unbox this guy and get started on pulling it out of the box. So we've cut the straps on the printer. One thing we did want to mention is it can be handy to actually cut off the UPC code of the box. This can come in handy if Epson is running any kind of promotion or something like that. So we do recommend one of the ends of the box will have this UPC code. Just cut it out, hold on to it. You never know when it can become beneficial. So what we'll do now is show you on one of the ends of the box, we have a big sticker that basically says to open for installation instructions. So if you're not into watching these videos, you basically have a step-by-step guide right here in the cutout for the box. So we went ahead and just scored that, pull that out, and this is the actual setup guide to assemble the printer. All right, so we'll get this out of the way for now. As I mentioned, you're gonna need help with this. Mark has volunteered to fly to your location and help out, just kidding. Go ahead, Southern, it's open. And then at the top of the box is actually another smaller box which houses the stand. So we'll just go ahead and pull that out, and then we'll go ahead and unbox this part and then assemble the stand. So here we have the stand box. We went ahead and scored the tape. We'll open this guy up, and inside we basically have two legs. All right, we have a left and right leg. Mark will grab his, take those out. We also have the crossbar between the legs, and then we also have the basket. And then finally, the hardware for the basket and the printer. So that's the contents of the stand box. We'll go ahead and put that together now. Okay, so the next step is to go ahead and put the stand together. It's very straightforward, very easy and quick. So the bag that Mark just threw to me had six bolts. We're going to take three on each side, and then we're going to take a leg. They are marked left and right, as well as the crossbar is marked left and right, so we'll just match the L to the R, or L to the L, and then the R to the R, and go ahead and put those together. Get that in straight. And then we'll take our three bolts on each side, so a total of six, and go ahead and screw this guy in. Tighten it down. It does include a wrench to do that tightening. So we'll go ahead and get this tightened down and then continue. All right, so we're close to getting the printer on the stand itself. But before we do that, we'll go ahead and get some loose items out of the top of the box. Let's go ahead and take a look inside what's inside the top. All right, we'll go ahead and pull those out. So first is the actual printer basket, not the rod assembly for the basket. That was in the other box. We'll get the media and adapters, media roll adapters out. And then there's a couple of pieces of styrofoam. Mark's got some brackets for the media eject. And we'll just go ahead and get all of this out. We'll also remove any of the inside cardboard that's in the box. It'll just make it easier to get the rest of the box off. So there's two long sheets on the front and back side. And then we'll just go ahead and lift off the remaining box. So at this point, we're going to go ahead and get all of the packing material removed. All right, and get ready, get some additional help to lift this guy onto the stand. So we've got the stand positioned in front of the printer. Again, the stand is marked left and right. Left is as you're standing in front of it, left side, right on the right. What we like to do, this thing is big and heavy. So if you're used to dealing with a P9000 or a 9900, you could do that with two, three people. This, you definitely want to stay with four people lifting this printer. And it's nice to have a spotter if you've got a fifth person to help you guide it onto the stand. Well, what we like to do is actually remove a lot of the styrofoam. So it just allows us to basically get in a little bit more closely with the printer, not have to work around the styrofoam. We've removed a lot of the plastic as well so we don't trip over it when we pick this guy up. The printer basically has a handle here, a handle on that side, and then we've got a little gap in the styrofoam over here that we're gonna basically grab like this. On the back side, we've got another handle. We're going to grab it here, and then underneath the bottom part of the printer, not up here where the plastic is, underneath the bottom is where the other hand goes. Same thing over here. If you're unsure where to grab it, definitely refer to the setup guide. It will tell you where you can grab it, where you can't grab it. What we'll do is we'll go ahead and get that help and get it put on the stand. Okay, so in this case, we've got four lifters and a spotter. If you don't happen to have a spotter, take reference to the way we've got the stand positioned. Basically, we've got it centered almost in between the two ink bay covers. This being an ink bay cover, that being an ink bay cover. So if you've got it centered where this left edge is a little bit over that bay cover, right edge a little bit over that one, that's basically where it's going to stand. The post is kind of right about here in this area. All right, so when you get it lifted up, pulled forward and down, you'll kind of feel it notch into those posts. Don't freak out if you don't get it immediately. There's a little bit of a feel for it, and you can let it rest. And then if you don't have that spotter, one of the people that got it onto the stand can then free up and then position the stand and help it get it positioned there. So we'll go ahead and lift it up and put it on. One, two, three. So we've got the printer on the stand. Basically, there's a couple of wing nuts, wing bolts with some washers, lock washers. We'll go ahead and screw that, tighten it down, but that's it. It's not complicated, it's just heavy. All right, so we're now ready to go ahead and put together the basket. So basket's got a few parts. You can see we've got it laid out. We did remove all the blue tape and packing material from all the parts. Got the main basket, it's retractable fabric. You've got a round rod, a square rod, two smaller square rods, the caps, pins, two strings, and then two plastic pieces. You'll see where all this stuff goes here in a second. So what we'll do is we'll go ahead and I'm gonna pull out the basket. So as far as orientation, there's a button on the right-hand side of the basket, and that helps retract the basket or rewind it. So have that button on the right-hand side. Next, what we're gonna do is we're gonna take the round rod. What I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna flip this over for visuals. There's a little pocket on the back side or bottom side of that basket. So if I flip it over, I'm gonna insert that rod right into that pocket. All right, so we've got that inserted. A little's poking out over here and on the other side. Next, I'm gonna go ahead and retract towards the back. I'm gonna run around to the back. I am gonna need these two clips for the back side, and you'll see why in a second. So we'll keep pulling until we can get back to these black plastic pieces. You'll see that there's a little groove that the round rod will sit down in. So I'll just push that, you'll hear it clip. Next, there's a string on that little extra flap of fabric. I'm gonna pull that up and loop it around the little black piece back here. Same thing on the left side. Okay, the two plastic loops are gonna hold these strings here. So what we'll do is there's a hole on the bottom left side of the metal portion of the printer. We'll go ahead and click that in. All right, and then we'll unhook it. We'll take the left side, go ahead and put it in that loop, and then do the exact same thing on the right side. All right, so that we're pretty much done at that point with the back side of the printer and the basket assembly. So, next step, go ahead and pull this out a little bit further. Next thing we're going to do is we'll go ahead and assemble this portion. So you'll see on these shorter rods, we've got a hole, a pinhole, or a little bit wider than a pinhole, and a white line. That's the bottom. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna put these caps basically on the top portion with the hole in that cap on the same side as the hole in the bottom of the rod. So we'll do that for the left and the right. So hole, white line, and then hole facing inward on the same side as the white line. Next, we'll go ahead and insert the longer rod into each end of those caps. Then what we'll do is we'll go ahead and slide this underneath like that. So what we're going to do next is basically take, you'll see on the fabric basket, these little loops. We're going to go ahead and loop those around the black plastic piece. All right, and then put the end that's closest to the basket all the way under that black bracket. So we're in that slot, and then we'll repeat over there. I'm going to go ahead and grab one of these pins, because after I loop this second one, so again, grab the loop, put it over into that rectangle groove, and then the bottom underneath that loop. Now with these pins, the way that they work is they're going to help secure these rods to the base of the stand. So on the left-hand side of this leg, on the right side of that leg, there's a hole. The pin goes into the hole and then through the hole on the bottom of this rod here, securing it to the printer. So we put the rod in the slot, put the pin in the side, and then basically insert the pin through the rod and through that hole and then all the way through, and that secures this to the stand. the last step to putting the basket together involves these two loops. There's one loop for each side, so I'll get this one out of the way. So what we're going to do is we're going to take one of the end of the rope loop and loop it around the black portion of that pin that we installed earlier. Next thing we're going to do is this is attached to the basket. So we're just going to loop this through one of the loops on this rope and then just loop it on that pin. So it's just holding this basket taut. So what we're going to do is take the other one, go on to the other side, the left side of the printer, and install this one as well. So the last thing on assembly is to go ahead and install the paper eject guides. We went ahead and installed the first three so you can see how they are on the printer. These are going to hook into the printer. So two knobs on the side, I can squeeze these in. And on the bottom side of the printer, there are these little clips where these pins go into. So I'll just kind of angle it in, you'll feel it click, and that one's installed. We'll go ahead and do the same thing for the last one. And again, I'd already done those other three over there. So really the last step before we plug it in, power it up, put the ink in, is to go ahead and get all of the tape packing material off of the printer. So one thing I want to show you, we're going to go ahead and remove all that off camera, but one of the most important is actually inside the printer. I've removed the tape that tapes this down. And right here, this actually little clip, styrofoam clip, holds the print head in place during shipping. So we're going to just remove that tape and then just pull out that clip. So we can hold on to this for a later time if we're ever going to physically move the printer, put it in a vehicle or something like that. So we'll just hold on to that. So from this point on, we're just going to spend our time removing all of the blue tape that Epson seems to love. So we'll get that done and then show you how to power it on and put the ink in. All right, so we're gonna go ahead and power it up. Now is actually a good time to show you the other connections because the power connection is right next to the data cable connection. So we have one end of the power cable plugged into an AC outlet. As you're standing in front on the right side of the printer or where your connections are, we've got the power. So we'll go ahead and pop that sucker in right there. Up here, we've got three ports. You've got a RJ45 Ethernet network port, so if you want to hook it up to your network. You also have a USB-B port, which is a standard output end of a USB cable. And then finally down here, you've got a USB-A port. This port is only used if you connect a optional take-up reel or SpectraProofer to the printer. And we can talk about that in another video, but you generally won't use this port unless you're powering up a take-up reel or a SpectraProofer. So at this point, we're ready to go ahead and turn on the printer. The power button's right here on the front lower left-hand corner of the LCD panel. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna push and actually hold that for a second. Don't push it and release it real quick. It won't turn on, you'll freak out. Just push it, hold it for about a second, and it'll boot up. So once we've got it powered on for a couple of seconds, the color LCD screen will come up and it'll ask us to select a language. We're gonna go ahead and go with English. All right, so the new printer has a touch screen. So this 9570-7570 comes with a touch screen, no more buttons to kind of toggle through, so you just touch right on the screen. Next, it's asking me for a date format. So whatever date format you approve, you would like, and then also what time and what date it is. So we'll go ahead and plug that in, hit OK, and then 12-hour format, hit OK, and then the time, and hit OK. All right, so basically, it's actually, this is a good little message here, because we were messing around with the tape. It's actually warning us, hey, this cover is actually open. So when I closed it, I didn't close it all the way, and I can see that end right there wasn't closed all the way. So it gave me a warning. Now it's going to continue and get ready to charge the ink system. So basically, the inks are located in this brown box. The brown box is actually sitting on the bottom of the pallet in front of the printer. So we just pulled that out when we were unboxing it. All right, so in the brown box, you'll see all of the ink cartridges. Now, I went ahead, these are individually wrapped, so I went ahead and already took the plastic off of them. But anytime you're installing ink into the printer or any Epson printer, you always want to give it a shake. All right, so if it's a new ink cartridge going in the future, you always want to give it a shake. So you want to kind of shake it flat, like so.
All right, so just a tip, because we do a lot of installations of these printers, I like to do one of these numbers so I don't have to shake all of the cartridges individually. So we're gonna give this a shake for about 10 seconds. All right, so all the cartridges are getting shaken right now. And then we'll go ahead and start to install them. Now to install them, again, a little bit different for those P9900 customers, P9000 customers. There's a button you hit, releases pressure, and then you put the inks in. Well, now it's back to the good old, just open it. I like this a lot better, it's a lot faster. So we'll go ahead and open both covers. All right, there's a left and a right, six on each side, 12 color system. So then we'll go ahead and install them. When installing ink cartridges, they're labeled. All right, they're also notched. All right, so these basically can't go into the wrong slot unless you physically try to cram them in there. All right, so we'll look at it, right reading, so the C up, and then we'll slide it in, and then you'll feel it click into place. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna go ahead and install all 12 ink cartridges and then come back. All right, so we got the last cartridge installed on the left side of the printer. We got them all on the right side. We'll go ahead and close that door. Once we close that door, the front panel recognizes that. Now it's checking to see if all of those cartridges are Epson genuine ink cartridges, as well as they were installed correctly. So it's checking those chips, seeing what kind of cartridges there are, because there are different sizes of ink cartridges. These are the starter cartridges, the 110 milliliter ink cartridges that come with the printer. All right, so there's 150, there's 350, and there's 700 milliliter options that you can purchase later, but the starter cartridges are 110 milliliters. So the printer is preparing. You can see actually the front, in the front, you can see the print head moving over to the left side of the printer. So it's just checking itself at this point, make sure everything was good, no damages in shipping. So it's just kind of moving left to right. And then once it finishes that, it's gonna begin charging the ink, all right? So when it's charging the ink, all right, it's putting all of the ink from the cartridges into the plumbing of the printer, the tubing, getting it over to the head, all right? So during this process, the ink is not really being consumed or used or wasted. It's actually just filling the sub-ink tank system. So basically, it is putting that ink, you will use it, but once it finishes that process, you're gonna look at your ink tank reservoirs, what's left inside those tanks, and they're gonna be down low, all right? It's not that you're wasting the ink, not using the ink, it just used that ink to fill that plumbing. That ink will go down on your prints and you will be using that ink for your printing. So, but at that point, you wanna really think about, all right, how many prints am I gonna get, okay? So it really depends, right? So what are you printing? Are you printing dark images? Are you printing light images? How big are you printing? How much ink is going down? So I would say on average, on a 44 inch printer, you'll probably get 30 or 40, 40 inch wide by 30 inch tall prints. And then maybe one of the lighter colors like gray or light gray will actually run out, okay? So, think about that. Think about ordering, calling DTG to order those replacement ink cartridges when you set up the printer. All right, so basically on the front panel of the printer, it's now telling us, hey, this initialization is beginning. All right, it's given us an estimated time of about 45 minutes to complete this process. So that pump is filling that ink line. All right, at this point, it's gonna take about 45 minutes. We're gonna let it do its thing and then come back and show you the rest. All right, fast forward 45 minutes, and here we go. The printer basically finished charging the ink, and it comes to the ready home screen, where it shows you the ink levels. Again, as we described earlier, the ink levels are down because it had to fill the plumbing of the printer. So one thing I actually do want to mention about charging ink, real important that you do not turn the printer off or lose power in that initial charge, because if it does lose power, it will assume nothing happened, and then when you turn it back on, it will want to completely charge again. So it'll end up wasting a ton of ink. You may even need replacement cartridges. So if your building that you're in tends to lose power, or there's thunderstorms here in Florida, we get that a lot, I highly recommend putting it on a UPS battery backup so that you don't lose power, okay? So with that said, what we're gonna do is we're really ready to print, ready to load paper and print. Before, the first thing I do after setting up a printer is I run a nozzle check, all right? The nozzle check tells me if the print head is firing correctly. So what we'll do is we'll actually show you how to do a nozzle check. We'll load sheet paper. We like to show this just because you can run a nozzle check on a 44-inch wide roll, but you end up wasting paper, right? Especially if it's canvas or fine art paper or whatever. Why not do it on cheap copy paper, okay? So what we're gonna do is go ahead and load this sheet. When loading a sheet, we're gonna come to the front panel and there's a roll icon. That's your paper icon. Right now it's blank, all right, because there's nothing loaded. So I'm gonna go ahead and hit that icon and then it's gonna give me the choice to load a roll, a cut sheet, or poster board, which goes in a little bit differently. So we're gonna go ahead and select cut sheet, all right, and it's kind of walking us through on the front panel, showing us what to do. All right, so to load a cut sheet, the new printers have this little slot, okay? I'm gonna open up that slot, and I'm gonna feed that down into the printer, all right? There's also a paper icon, all right, with a vertical line. I'm gonna put that paper on that line, that right edge of the paper right on that line, okay? I'm gonna leave that open, that paper slot open, and then I'm gonna hit complete in the upper right-hand corner. It's then asking me, hey, is it straight? All right, it actually grabbed the paper for a second. Is it straight or is it crooked? All right, everything's good, so I'm gonna hit okay. So once I hit okay, a next menu comes up and asks me what kind of paper type it is. All right, so in this case, it's plain paper. Right now, I've got it on the plain paper setting, but if it had come up with something different, I wanna go ahead and change that to tell the printer what kind of paper is that I'm loading into the printer. So I would hit more paper types, all right? And basically that's gonna give me a list and family of paper types, matte paper, canvases, fine art paper, and others, all right? So in this case, I've got plain paper, so I would just select that. If I wanted to select something else, I would go into that family and select the specific Epson paper that I'm using, all right? So in this case, we're plain paper. Now with that said, if you were loading a third party paper, if you were loading Hahnemuhle or Canon or Reflections, what you would want to do is, obviously those aren't going to show up on the front panel of the printer immediately. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to pick something similar in thickness. So if it's a Reflections Vista canvas, I would select Epson Exhibition Canvas. All right, something similar in thickness. All right, so again, in this case, we're going to stick with the plain paper. All right, we can also select the paper size. So right now I've got an 8.5 by 11, so I can click on that, select 8.5 by 11. And then once I do that, I'm gonna click OK. It's gonna grab the paper, feed it into the printer, and then basically measure the paper. It's gonna measure the width of that paper. Anytime you load a cut sheet or a roll into the printer wants to come out, find the left edge, find the right edge of the paper, and then it measures it. It also checks to make sure it's positioned correctly here. So if I had pushed this over here to the right too far, or pushed it over to the left too far, it would give me a load error, wouldn't sense it because it's looking for that. It doesn't have to be perfect, but it's gotta be about within 1/8 of an inch of that line, okay? So make sure you get it close to that line. So basically doing its thing here, feeding it back and forth, making sure everything's straight, it's happy, and then once it finishes that, it's gonna take us to the home screen on the front panel of the printer, like it is now, all right? So again, I wanna run a nozzle check. All right, make sure my print head is in good operating condition. So on the new printers, we've got the touch screen again. So they've got a shortcut to the maintenance, and it's basically a printer with a wrench symbol. So I'm just gonna click that, all right? And then right at the top, first thing, most common, print head nozzle check, I'm gonna click that, all right? And then basically I'm gonna hit start, and it's gonna go ahead and print a nozzle check pattern. So what it's doing in this case is every single color has got a lot of nozzles for it. So it's gonna fire ink through every single one of those nozzles for each color in a pattern. All right, once it finishes, I'm gonna eject the paper. I'm gonna look at that pattern, all right, and check and make sure that there's no clogs, all right? How do I know what a clog is? It's a missing line, all right? There's a stair-step pattern for each nozzle, and if I've got a gap or a missing line, I know there's a nozzle clog. Now, one thing to mention on these printers is they do feature auto nozzle check, right? So The auto nozzle check feature before each print will go in and check to make sure the nozzles are firing, all right, and make sure that the nozzles are good. Sometimes I like to disable that. One, it slows the printer down a little bit because it's got to perform that nozzle check. But we've seen in many instances, especially where the printer's by a window where there's a lot of light coming in, it can kind of mess with that sensor a little bit and you'll get false readings. It'll say there's a nozzle clog and there's not actually a nozzle clog there. Print a nozzle check out, it's perfect. So in those cases, I'll get calls, we'll tell customers, go ahead and turn that feature off. And you can do that in the front panel of the printer. And we'll talk about that in some other videos. But again, this is why I like to do a physical nozzle check. I like to lay my eyes on it and make sure everything is good. So basically, it ran that print. I'm gonna click, it's holding the paper. So to release it, I'm just gonna push OK on the front panel. All right, so here, all right, we can see basically our nozzle check pattern. All right, big print head. Look at the size of that sucker. So if you guys are used to P9000s or 9900s, you can basically see this is a much bigger print head, why it's so fast. All right, so a lot more nozzles. I'm just visually inspecting, looking for gaps or lines missing. Everything looks good. So basically, we've got a good nozzle check on the printer. All right, so that's how you load cut sheet paper and run a nozzle check. So one more thing after the nozzle check, it's asking me, all right, hey, how does it look? Does it look bad or does it look good? All right, so gaps, I'm gonna hit X. If it looks good, I'm gonna hit O. All right, if I had hit X, it would bring me to the cleaning menu. The cleaning menu would allow me to basically clean the entire print head, all the colors. Why do I want to do that if I've only got one problem, right? It'll also allow me to clean color pairs, okay? So two colors at a time instead of all 12 colors. So I would pick which color was clogged, run it just on that pair so I'm not wasting a bunch of ink when I clean, okay? So at this point, I can go ahead and just close that flap. The reason they did this is basically this little flap, instead of lifting this all the way up if you're doing a lot of cut sheet printing, it's just a lot less susceptible to get dust in the machine, all right, and dust in the print head area. So now they've got this really, really nice slot where I can feed that poster board or that fine art paper. Also, when feeding sheets, feed them tall. Don't feed them like this, feed them tall. Much easier to deal with if you do that. You can do cut sheets, scraps. So if I had some leftover from a 44 inch roll that was, you know, 13.5 inches by 18.5, I could very, very easily feed that into the printer. All right. So obviously one more thing, we can feed roll paper in the 44 inch printer. We're not only going to feed sheet. When we're dealing with roll paper, you'll notice basically some paper comes on a 2 inch core. And then some paper comes on a 3 inch core, all right? So what we're gonna do is we're gonna grab the roll media adapters. And these have been around for 3 or 4 generations of the printers. This is the best thing going compared to the competition on the market because the competition uses a spindle or a stick to load paper. All right, kind of a pain. These are awesome. Basically, they've got a 2 and 3 inch adapter in them. There's a little slider right here that I just slide and it'll go convert to 3 inch or back to 2 inch. Okay, so to load paper, all right, what I can do, I can take my roller, I can pop it up on top of the printer. The printer's got a groove in the top surface of it so that it can hold the paper roll. So I'm going to take this to a 3 inch core. On the adapter, there's a handle. All right, when I pull that handle out, these flanges right here shrink in. All right, when I push it in, it grips out. Okay, so if I try to have this in and put it inside the core, it's not going to fit. Okay, that's why I've got to take, flip that handle out. Now it freely goes in and out. Then when I close it, it's gripped, those flanges grip out so it can grip the inside of the core. So I'll do the same thing over on the left side. All right, to load the roll. All right, just move this over here. We basically have the roll mechanism here. So you'll see a lock and an unlock button. All right, so I'm gonna take that to the unlocked position so I can freely move that left to right. So that all depends on what size roll. If I've got a shorter 17 inch roll, this is gonna be over here, 24, 36, 44, etc. So basically I'm gonna position this. All right, I don't know if you guys can see this, but there's also arrows on these adapters. So that tells you where to line up your roll when you're positioning it on top of the printer. So on the right side, it's really easy actually. So when we put this up here, there's a little plastic flange right here. If I push and it stops, I know the right edge is lined up. So then I'm gonna take this where the left arrow is, line it up on my roll, and then just simply roll this into the printer. Then I'm gonna grab this handle and lock it in place. So I'm just gonna push it to the right. That puts it all the way into the pin in the position it needs to be. Then I'm gonna lock this lever. Okay, important to lock that lever. If you don't, the cover won't close. So I'm gonna lock that lever. All right, so that's why I'm locking it. At this point, basically the printer, because I've got that locked, senses that I'm loading roll paper. It senses it automatically. So it's telling me what to do on the front panel. All right, so basically it's asking me, do I wanna load roll paper? Yes. All right, so basically I hit the set button. I'm gonna go ahead and insert the paper, and you're gonna hear a beep. All right, when I hear that beep, I can basically close the cover. All right, it's asking me what kind of paper it is. All right, so I'm gonna come here. This is a premium glossy photo paper. So I'm gonna click paper type to change it. I'm gonna say more paper types. It is a photo paper, so I'm gonna go to that family, and then I'm gonna go to the Epson Premium Glossy 250. That's the roll paper I have, okay? Then I'm gonna click okay, and now it's gonna feed the paper into the printer. Again, just like it did with sheet, it's gonna find that left edge, right edge, whether it's a 17, 24, 36, 44, whatever size it is, it measures it. The reason it does that is because if I accidentally sent a 44 inch wide image from Photoshop or my print application, and I had a 24 inch roll in there, it's smart enough to know not to print, all right, on the beyond the edge of the paper. So that's why it does the paper size check. All right, so just like sheet doing its thing, all right, once everything is finished and checked, it's happy, it will return us to the home screen and we're ready to print. All right, one last thing we wanted to show you on the actual operation of the printer is the basket. We get a lot of questions about the basket, you know, what's it there for? So basically, this new basket is a retractable basket. So basically, if I flip this out like this, prints will basically come out and go underneath the printer. They'll kind of wind up by themselves depending on what kind of paper or canvas it is. All right, but I can also pick the basket up and actually pull it forward. All right, and the idea here is if you got a really expensive, nice print coming out, it will come out, lay flat, and scoop out across the carpet or the floor. So it's a running joke here at DTG that we feel like the engineering intern is the guy that designs the basket on these printers because they're complicated to put together and they're kind of, eh. This one actually, this guy was pretty sharp. I like this basket because it's really nice. It's a nice presentation as far as the prints coming out. Keeps them well protected, okay? So now one thing to get this back in, all right, you'll notice I just pulled it to get it out. There's a button on the far right-hand side of the retractor, all right? So to get this back in, I'm gonna push and hold that button so that it auto winds up, all right? And to put it back, there's a little ledge here, so we'll just put that there, and that's how you use the retractable basket.
So Epson no longer ships the drivers or software in the printer box, so we need to go online and download those drivers from Epson.com. A real quick way to actually access any drivers for any product is to go to DTGweb.com, our website, and then just search for the product that you're looking for the drivers for. So we'll search, click on the product,
And many of our hardware products will have this support link. On that, you'll see videos, you'll see user links to user guides, as well as links to the latest drivers and firmwares. So when I click on that, what it does is it takes me to Epson.com, automatically detects my operating system, and allows me to download the drivers. So I'll click on drivers in this case. All right, I'm going to download the entire driver and utilities combo package. So we'll click download. That will take it to my downloads folder. And this is the P9570 installer package. So when I double click that, I'll basically open up the application to install the drivers. Now, it's important to note what's happening here is basically the first download was just a link to all of this software. So when I click install, it's actually downloading more software. So there's two downloads that take place. And the reason I point that out is some people will actually download on one computer and then install on another. So there are two downloads involved with this installer. All right, so we'll just click through, enter your password for your computer to start the installation process. And this will install all of the printer drivers, all right, so which are basically the apps that allow you to print from your applications like Photoshop to the printer, as well as additional utilities, network configuration utility, media configuration utility, and other software updaters for the P9570. So once it downloads and installs those apps, we're going to basically step through this process. So we'll click start. It's asking us what connection do you have? How are you connected? And as you saw earlier in the video, we could connect through USB from our computer directly to the printer's USB connection or through a wired network connection. So that wired network connection could theoretically be a Ethernet cable, a network cable from your computer directly to your printer, or more commonly, the printer is connected to your router or your switch. Okay, so in this case, we're connected through our company network on our switch. So I'm going to say wired network connection and click continue. All right, the printer is actually already on my Ethernet network. All right, so meaning I've already connected it and it basically has an IP address. So I'm going to click this. If it wasn't connected, I would click the setup printer for the first time and it would search, all right, and find it. So basically, when I hit continue, it found it on my existing Ethernet network, and we're just going to hit continue. Then we're going to click add printer. All right, it takes us to the system preferences of our Macintosh. This should look familiar, and sure enough, there is the P9500 series in our list of available printer drivers. Now, you'll notice down here it says Epson SC P9500 series. Make sure it says that, because sometimes, depending on the operating system, it might get confused and you might see a generic name here for the printer driver. If it shows a generic name and not this Epson SC P9500 series, then you won't get all of the features. You won't be able to manage the color properly. So make sure it says this, all right, down here in the use section. So we'll click add. All right, so it's basically adding that printer, all right, to our Macintosh operating system, and allows me to print to it now. So now it's just asking you if you want to register. No, I'm not going to register, but you can register the product now. And basically, this will take you through the process of registering if you choose to do it. But that's pretty much all there is to installing the drivers on a Macintosh computer. Then it takes us to the media installer application. So what this is a new feature for the 7500-9500 series. The intent here with this application is to make it easier in the future to add new custom media. So as Epson develops new medias, they will have them in the cloud. And what you can use is this Epson media installer application to basically go to the cloud and search for new available media types. And when you click on those media types and download them, it will automatically download an ICC profile as well as download all of the driver related files that need to go in for the custom media. It also syncs that computer and that new media that you just downloaded to the printer. So then you'll see this new printer media in the actual menu of the printer itself. So again, the intent here is to make adding and installing new Epson custom medias a lot easier and a lot more streamlined than it used to be. You used to have to download a whole new driver, change firmwares, download manually, install the ICC profiles. Well, the media installer tool does that for you all automatically. All right, one more thing. We also like to tell customers to check and verify that you have the latest firmware on the printer, especially a new printer install. Many times they have been in a warehouse on a shelf and they may not have the latest and greatest firmware. And from here we can see today is about August 14th or so. The latest firmware came out 3 weeks or so ago. So basically the printer that we have may not have the latest firmware. So I'll click download, all right, and that will download the firmware. I'm going to go to my downloads folder, and then when that finishes, we're going to go ahead and double click that. All right, so it's opening up that firmware application file. We're going to double click the Epson firmware updater. We're going to open. All right, and it's going to check for us. So when I click next, agree to the license. All right, so it sees the firmware file. Now it's looking out on the printer itself. May take a second. All right, and basically it says new version. All right, so yes, we needed to update the firmware. So we're going to go ahead and click start, and it will update the firmware on the printer. All right, what's the firmware? Well, the firmware is the software or brains inside the printer itself. And what Epson will periodically do is update and improve features on the printer. They may improve the cleaning algorithms. They may improve the way media is fed through the printer. So basically, typically new firmwares will make your printer better. You may not notice it, but behind the scenes, it's making your printer more reliable and better. All right, so that's the firmware updater. At that point, we're pretty much done, and on a Macintosh, we're ready to go ahead and start printing once this firmware is updated. So that's it for downloading, installing the software on a Macintosh, as well as updating the firmware on the printer. So let's move on and install the drivers on a Windows platform. As mentioned before, software and drivers don't ship in the box, so we need to download them online. A quick and easy way to find drivers for products that we sell at dtgweb.com is just go to our website, search for the product, click on the product, and then most of our hardware product will have this support link here. So when I click on that, you'll see links to the user guide, videos, also links to the latest drivers and firmware. So when I click on that, it actually takes me directly to the Epson driver site for the P9570 or the product we're looking for, detects our operating system, and shows us the appropriate drivers. So in this case, we're going to click on the drivers, and we want to download this entire drivers and utilities combo package. So when I click on that, it's going to begin the download for this software install. Now, it's important to note that this process will actually, once I launch this application, it's going to connect to the internet again and download additional software. So what this software is the printer drivers, as well as the media configuration files, as well as the Epson Net Config utility, which we'll see in a second here. So all of the necessary files to start the download. So what I'll do is I'll go to my downloads folder and double click the installer file. Say yes, click OK, and it's going to begin the installation package. Again, after it does this initial install, it's actually going to connect to the internet again and download additional software. So don't begin the download or do the download on one computer and then start it on another computer that doesn't have a network connection. You need to have that internet connection through the entire process. So we'll install all of the options, including the Net Config utility, as well as the printer driver itself. Now, Epson will periodically come out with new drivers, and typically, depending on your computer's configuration, it will automatically detect that and let you know that there's new drivers out there for you. So there's the Epson NetConfig utility. That's utilized to set IP address, see different Epson computers on your network, your wired network. So we'll click Next to begin the setup. Here, it's asking us, hey, what is your connection? USB, so a direct USB cable from your computer to the printer, or a wired network connection. Now, that wired network connection could be an Ethernet cable connected directly from your computer to the printer, or more typically, it's connected on your network, meaning your computer's already on a wired network, as well as your printer was connected to a wall outlet or your wired switch or router. So in this case, we are definitely connected to our network, our company network. So I'm gonna select that, click Next. All right, set up the printer for the first time, or the printer is already on my Ethernet network. Well, it's already on my network, okay? So I'm gonna go ahead and select that because we've already connected it. The IP address has been configured. All right, that may be done by you or, you know, IT staff that you have, but it is already on our network. Now, the interesting thing is it's searching for that printer when I selected that. So it's going out and seeing if it's there. Now, it probably won't find it, and the reason is because I'm actually running Windows on a Macintosh right now through Parallels, and the Ethernet and network proxies and all that can confuse this. So this is good that we're seeing this because it may happen on your computer. Probably not, but if it does, there's a workaround here. So what I'm going to do is you'll notice or remember that it installed a network utility called Epson Net. So I'm going to actually launch that program, and it's going to search our network for Epson printers. And we're looking for the 9570. So there it is. And it shows me, hey, it's got an IP address of this ending in .95. So what I'm gonna do, if it doesn't automatically find my printer, all I'm gonna do is click Advanced and then type in the IP address that I see in Epson NetConfig. Now we'll be able to cruise through the installation. All right, so we manually told it where it was on that IP address, and we're good to go and good to continue. All right, so we'll just click Finish. It's going to ask us to register. We're not going to do that right now. And then it basically is going to install the media installer tool. All right, so that media installer tool, by the way, is a new feature for the P75-9500 series, in which basically as Epson comes out with new medias, you'll be able to go to the cloud and download those medias and add them to your computer and printer. It used to be a very cumbersome process to do that with manually installing ICC profiles, updating drivers and firmwares. Well, now with the media installer tool, I can download, it will automatically put all of the files on your computer that you need and push and sync that to your printer, so it's available on your printer as well. Really nice application, and makes things easier with adding new custom medias and new Epson medias. So that pretty much is installing the Epson printer driver and software on Windows. Now, one other thing we always like to talk about is the firmware. All right, so the firmware are the brains of the printer. So we always recommend downloading the latest version of the firmware to verify and see if your printer is running the latest firmware. All right, and it's always a good idea to be running the latest firmware. So we'll go ahead and launch that and get it installed. And typically, again, with the new printers, they don't have the latest firmware because they may have been sitting on a shelf in a warehouse somewhere for quite some time, and Epson may have come out with a new firmware. So the updater tool will download the latest firmware file for you, and then it'll check your printer to see if it's running the latest firmware. All right, so here's the firmware in the file. All right, it's going out on the network looking at the printer model, the P9570, and will let us know if it's running the latest firmware or not. Well, in this case, we're actually running the latest firmware because I just downloaded and updated it on the Macintosh demo video. So we're good to go on the firmware. So no need to update it, but we always do recommend downloading and updating the printers to the latest firmware, especially for brand new printers, because they're more than likely not running the latest firmware. So that's downloading and installing the software drivers for your P7570 or 9570 on Windows.
So that was our unboxing, assembly, and installation video for the new P9570, as well as its little brother, the P7570. If you're a DTG customer, thank you. We truly appreciate your business and the opportunity to help you guys grow. If you're not a DTG customer, we'd love to earn your business. We're standing here in our Epson Certified Solution Center here in Tampa. We'd love to have you guys in to see all of the latest Epson equipment, as well as the accessories that go with it. Epson has chosen Digital Technology Group as one of a handful of Certified Solution Center partners in North America, the only one in the Southeast United States. So again, thank you. We'd love to earn your business. And if you have any questions or comments, contact information is at the bottom of this video. Take care and appreciate it.